My name is Michael Morrison. I work with the NSPCC, a consultant social worker, and I am based in the Foyle office. I'm here today to talk about a service that's actually very, very close to my heart, something that I feel very, very passionate about, that's delivered just in the Foyle area. I don't believe it's not delivered in Belfast, it's not delivered in Craig Young as well, so this is a Foyle specific service, and it's called Face to Face. So the presentation, so we're going to pick a part of three of our stuff. We're going to see why did the NSPCC say we develop this service, who's it for, what's it about. Like all the services that we do, they've all been formally evaluated, so I'm going to go, and not into great detail about the evaluation, but I'm going to deliver some of the things that we've found from face to face. And then because we've evaluated, what do we do with there? So that's how it's going to sort of take place, hopefully over 10, 15 months. So we'll start. If I can press that button, there we go. So, the rationale for the service. So why did they decide to do face-to-face? This is how it was born. So in 2011, the NSPCC commissioned the Who Cares Trust to gather the thoughts and views of 270 children in care. They also actually consulted with children who used the Childline service, which was also part of the NSPCC. And basically what they were asking the children to do was, if you could design a service, what would it look like? To see if we can come up with anything. So what children said that they wanted a service for someone they could trust, someone who would listen to them, and someone that wouldn't judge them. And they stand with some of our social work values. A face-to-face service support, rather than over the phone. So it made sense too, and they could solve each other charity as well too. Something they could access quickly. So something didn't take ages to come for someone who wanted to leave them. Something that wasn't too heavy for them. Someone that would help address their problems, the difficulties and issues they had in their lives. There's a part of it that's not included, but I also know that what the children were looking for was someone that didn't go back in and talk about the history. So the children would come in and use a service that they don't have to tell somebody new, this is what happened to you, this is the way I came into care. And then some of them would really get tangible change in their situation. So the whole premise is this, as a child was in control. They decided where they wanted to. They decided what they wanted to talk about, and he didn't want to go back in and talk about that stuff. So, the NSPCC then said, right, we'll design a service, we'll call it face to face. But who are we going to work with? So, in around 2011, part of the strategy was looking at and support looked after children. So, this is the service that they thought they would come in and use. So, we often look after children, adopted and owned in age of care. For us, at that time, we were still to try and explain who the service was for, so it was very easy to say children who are not loving at home. Okay, we actually got it expanded between 5 and 19. My experience is actually residential child care before I came to the NSPCC, and also I worked in the 16 plus team in the office as well too. So I also knew the children leaving care are also very vulnerable and can need support and would benefit from this type of support. So through our consultation, we actually get the age range moved up. So we work with 18 and 19 year olds who have left care as well too. But when you're looking at children who are living away from home, we're also including children who live in hospitals. We're also including children who live in, say, juvenile justice centres, maybe secure accommodation, kinship care placements as well too. But also children who are in the age of care, so this service is also set to try and sort of help prevent that. So we also support children who have an issue affecting their lives and impacting on their emotional well-being or placing them at risk. At the time of this report, it was delivered in 18 locations around the UK since September 2011. And altogether within that time, was 1,798 children used the service. And this approximate one full-time equivalent social worker was delivered the service. So basically what that means, within each service centre, there was designated, like say, 37 hours a week just to deliver the service, so one person technically wasn't just using the service. So we referred in, you weren't just getting one person. But that time was split up, the 37 hours was split up between four or five different people. So it was actually a very, very small resource that was put towards the service. So what else, face to face? So offers up to 8 sessions using solution focused approach. So face to face is using brief solution focused therapy. That's what it is. It's immediate response service. As soon as we take a referral, we contact the child within 24 hours. We might necessarily see them straight away, but what we'll do is make an appointment to meet them as soon as we can. So as soon as we get the referral on, go through our referral process and we accept the referral, we come in contact with the child directly to say, you're now working with us, where are we entering me? So exactly what I said before, serves as child there, child chooses to focus the work. They can also choose the frequency and location of the sessions. We offer a maximum of 8 sessions. I always say, let the children come and do it. Give it a go. After 3 sessions, we don't think you want to do it anymore. And we'll just stop. If you reach your goal after 5 seconds, reach towards your goal after 5 sessions, you want to continue on, we'll continue on. We also ask them, where do you want to meet? That comes with a wee bit of a caveat. We have confidentiality stuff, so we wouldn't necessarily meet and do the sessions on a cafe or something like that. So it could be school, somewhere confidential, where they feel comfortable, where they can talk. The difficulty sometimes with this is the child chooses to focus on the work. Because a lot of the time when we get referrals in, it's from a social worker or from a concerned parent or something. Wee Johnny needs to work on such and such. We go on and we try and explain to the referrer, look, what we're going to do and how this service works. It's the child has to have ownership of what they want to do and what they want. Hopefully, when we develop and sort of work out what skills and resources they're going to apply to this issue, it might also transfer something under what you want them to do. So the service can be accessed by a parent, care, professional, or by a young person themselves. But again, providing the child informed consent under pressure. So children can actually phone even our service centre, they can actually refer themselves through childline as well to access the service. And again, this is about confidentiality. The content assessment is not shared with others without the child doing. So I think that's a bit difficult. However, you know, if a child's at risk, there's child protection, safeguard consent, and our safeguarding policies and procedures kick in, so we would have to, when we talk about confidentiality and stuff like that in the very first session. What we also do is, something we've developed and following it now nationally, is we develop a thing called the social team. So when we meet the child at the start, we talk about what the service is. But we also say, well, is there anybody else that you would like to be kept informed? Or anybody else that could sort of help you and be aware of what we're going to be working on, so they can support you through it. And a lot of the time the children say, maybe social worker, maybe this and that, whatever. But if we are going to share information, we automatically seek the consent for the child as well too. So all together, all the children that have came in and used our service, these are sort of the main themes that they've worked on. We've also got themes like, I want to be a better singer, I want to be a better dancer, and stuff like that as well too, but these are the main thing. So developing safer strategies cope with emotions like anger, rejection, isolation, loss and anxiety, and managing behavioural issues. We have young people come in and use the service, we have young people who were self-harming. Which is not as a way to try and show how they were feeling and emotions and trauma and stuff like that we experienced. So we were working together to develop new healthier coping mechanisms. So. Improving communication with people in their lives, including foster carers, family members or siblings. School related issues is a big one that comes on that keeps cropping up. Some of them want to get on better in school, want to get on better with your teacher. One young girl I was working with, she was on the verge of expulsion. And through the first work, she was, after 8 weeks, she was receiving people a month for a year and stuff like that, which was really, really, really encouraging. All her own work. Being able to engage in healthy relationships and developing an insight into keeping safe and making safe choices. That's also the talk about internet and being safe and stuff like that with the children. And a big one then, I suppose, is increasing their self-confidence. The whole premise of this is trying to identify resources that the children already have and they're really using and they're really applying in different situations and applying these resources that they have and the issue that they identify. If I'm going too fast telling the story. So, this is evaluation. So we evaluate the service. We had to get consent from the children. We also had a consent to school for the person of parent responsible as well too from the tech club. We use quantitative and qualitative measures. The quantitative measure was an outcome, didn't say the ORS. So each child when they come in and they do a session with us, they completed this ORS. So ORS is a skate with four dimensions. And the child roots himself before they start assessing on where they are on each dimension of skating. So one aspect of skate is individual, so how they feel them right there and there. Interpersonal is how they get on their own and other relationships. The other one then is social, so how they get on school, work, whatever. And then the last one is overall. So they put themselves in a skating brace, social focus. So put themselves in a skating, see where they were. So all together, suppose out of the 1,700 children, 611 children participate in evaluation. And a further 103 of those then, we did a follow-up evaluation then, 3 months later, because we were trying to see if what we were assisting the children to develop, was it sustainable? Were they still using stuff that they identified within our first sessions, 3 months later? And on top of that, there was the qualitative stuff. There was 18 interviews with the children and young people. We all didn't think that it made sense with seeing how well the service was doing without asking other people who could also recognise if the children were working well. So that's what we interviewed the foster carers. And there were also the professionals from the NSPCC were also interviewed just to see what our thoughts were in the service. The main focus of trying to do that was trying to see how the children were experiencing the service, what were the barriers to the service so we could improve it. And these were the findings. So 611 children completed the evaluation. Nearly 60% of them showed reliable improvement levels of well-being at the end of the service. So 60% of the children we've seen would have been maybe at the lower end of the scale, and by the time they were finished on the ORS and SRS, they had moved at least up. Of the children who were most in need at the beginning of the service, those with the clinical levels of distress, 70% showed reliable improvement and ended the service with normal levels of well-being. 3 months after the last session, 8% of the children were still reporting increased levels of well-being. So that was a sample of 103 children. All this is formally published as well too in a report and embraced the facts and figures, throwing that wee bit more detail than what I have done up there. Someone who's a wee bit better in research methods has also written a report and explains it a lot better than what I have. Bar charts and pie charts. Graphs and written as well too. So anybody wants to see the formal evaluation, it wouldn't be a problem. I'll see these access there. So through the qualitative stuff and the interviews that we're doing with children, this is what someone was saying. So 73% said the face-to-face had helped them to solve their immediate concern that was affecting their emotional well-being. The service helped by listening to them, being confidential, encouraging them to reflect on issues, focusing on their strengths, giving them control over the process, and their rehearsing strategies to solve the problems. Referrals and foster carers found the referral process easy and were able to see the change in the young person. What is it the young people were telling us? I didn't know where to begin as I felt that I had just too much stuff to sort out. But the NSPCC worker helped me break this down, because if I worked my own confidence and going out, I could then make friends. I think it's like there was a wall in front of you and you just grabbed a hammer and smashed it down. The hammer would like the good things about yourself and you wouldn't put yourself down and you'd say something good about yourself. I always felt my social worker was always jumping on the bad things that I've done. But in the face-to-face service, the face-to-face worker was always looking for the good things I can do. I never thought that way. I've never done anything like that before. He made me think I can do stuff, that I can do better things. And I'd do better things, so it was very helpful. I could see them myself, so that's why I was noticing every time the scale went up, I was thinking, right, keep climbing, don't go down, keep climbing. So sharing our experience, so we have all this wonderful evaluation, all this wonderful knowledge and experience that we're giving the children. But we thought ourselves in NSPCC, how can we deliver that? How can we assist other people? We are approach. One of the first things we did was actually it came from a barrier that we identified ourselves. Our age range is working using a social focused approach, question technique, with 5-year-olds. And it's very, very, very difficult to do. So what we decided to do is we all got together and we developed this toolkit. So it's a toolkit for professionals who have already had some training in solution focused practice. And it helps develop skills in using this approach with children and young people, particularly. to include ideas for work sheets and activities the NSPCC practitioner plan to be held for each stage of social focus approach. So when the manual's free to download, it's the website and stuff we got up there. Stick it on the Google, NSPCC face-to-face toolkit, find out the model. And it is a list of resources that takes you through each stage of the solution focus process, both useful and helpful worksheets where you're not constantly having to show the back of questions all the time. The caveat with this is you need to have that solution focus trigger. And it makes sense. You know, worksheets possible in the longer when you do face to face, probably won't make sense. But in saying that, you know, there are some very, very useful and helpful worksheets you can use in Raleigh for our services and work on the children in general. Free to download. So the last one is a face-to-face implementation gear. For commissioners and service providers who are interested in delivering a service like face-to-face, so we provide the key message with the benefits of offering a service and describe the training and resources need to deliver face-to-face. So I think that's me finished. Any more information? Like I say, we deliver this in a quiet service setting. Unfortunately, what we used to do is my last act as an NSPCC employee. It's my last day, I believe. I'm sort of delighted that folks asked me to come and speak to them about a service and I'm very, very pleasant to prove that I've been. So, contact anybody at FOIA, there's our phone number up there. Use the email address as well, too. Anybody's interested in face to face and then we'll meet up on our way.
Well, it's a bit persistent that there are here in White Behaviour and Lunchtime Brian Seas actually face to face. So what I want to do is firstly introduce myself to you, Spears, and social worker with the NSPCC, or children services practitioners who are also I've been involved in a service called Caring Dads, which is about working with abusive and at-risk fathers to improve the safety and well-being of women and children. I'm going to talk a wee bit about how the service came about very briefly, because what I find often is that sometimes you forget to put things out or think about what's important to put in or what's best to leave out. So I'll do a quick run through of the service register and also the evaluation of key findings of the evaluation. And then I'll open up to questions, because sometimes that's where you also get the chance to ask about it in more detail. So the Caring Dads program, it's recognised that the impact of domestic abuse on children, both in terms of their emotional health, physical, both short term and long term, and there's a lot of research around the impact of domestic abuse on children. But what the idea is, it's also recognised in terms of working directly with the men to engage in domestic abusive behaviours, but that's the priority, that's the focus of this work. It is a programme, a mandated programme, that group work programme was developed in Canada by Karina Scott and Tim Kelly. So it originated in Canada, and NSPCC were looking at a service where children would focus. How would NSPCC, or what service would the NSPCC deliver that would work with adults, but focus principally on the children are actually the priority. So this Caring Dads program has been installed into work by Scott and Kelly. It uses men's role as fathers to motivate the change in behaviour, and it's about reducing, and therefore that leads to a reduction in risk in terms of their behaviour, the risk that they pose in terms of their domestic abuse behaviour. Why do we need services specifically for abusive fathers? There's a lot of research, or there has been a lot of research done in relation to men's engagement in protective services, or child protection services for children. And a lot of the research looks at the lack of engagement. And sometimes that's around looking at men's active avoidance of being involved in those services. It also looks at social services involved in terms of how they engage with men. So sometimes men won't engage because They don't see it as their role. They don't see, well, that's the mum's role is to take care of the child. I have nothing to do with this. They don't see it as their role in terms of changing behaviour. And also because they present as quite hostile and quite defensive, sometimes what was happening was a lot of professionals was to work out to avoid engaging with those families. That is changing. A lot of the initial research was looking at those fathers who were not engaging, and the role of professionals in sort of maintaining that. That is changing because a lot of professionals now acknowledge that the role of the father is very, very important, and the role of engaging men who could present as defensive and also present as abusive or hostile, that those men actually very important to engage. So there's more recognition there amongst professionals, and also in terms of trust to the trainer with the professionals as well. The programme itself seeks to reduce the impact of domestic abuse on children by working with the fathers to address their domestic abuse behaviours. It's about increasing the father's awareness of the impact of domestic abuse and neglect on the children. Enhancing the motivation to change by focusing on their men, on their role as fathers, and challenging in terms of reducing their attitudes that other men are contributing to the domestic abuse. It's also about supporting the improvement in the child-father relationship. And further on, then, it's also about support reduction in parental conflict between fathers and mothers of the child. Reducing fathers induced harm to the mother-child relationship as well, to increase the father's cooperation in parenting. As I mentioned earlier, it's a mandated programme, so it's a 17-week group work programme with four goals. The first three goals initially is around encouraging fathers to look at their own, how they were parented, what their childhood experiences were like of being raised by their father. And that's to help them in terms of thinking about, okay, well, what are the good things about my childhood that I'm bringing and continue to do with my own children? Or what are those things that I didn't enjoy? What are those things that I don't want to do the same as my dad? Okay? So it's asking, getting the first three sessions really about asking fathers to sort of reflect on their past. Keep a hold of those things that are positive, but also start to think about how has my own childhood started to influence my role and understanding of being a father, and influence my understanding of relationships between myself and the role of the mother as well. The second goal really is then about looking at the needs of the children. We spend a lot of time, I think it's about 5-6 sessions, looking principally at meeting the needs of the child. A lot of the fathers come thinking it's a parenting programme. And themselves and say, well, I don't know why I'm here, I'm a caring dad, there's no way I would have my child. As they go through the second goal, what they start to realise is, yes, there's a lot of positives there, they do care for the child. However, what they then start to realise is the impact of the domestic abuse on their ability to meet those needs of the children, and also the impact then on the relationship that the mother has with the child, and that the mother's ability to meet those child's emotional and developmental needs. We do some work around child development in terms of brain development as well, and the impact on brain development around anxiety, around stress, around attachment, and around due to domestic abuse, if the mother's not emotionally or physically available, how that can impact them on the attachment process as well. I think that's the turning point for a lot of the men, is because they say they come to thinking, caring dad, I'm a caring dad, why am I here? And as they continue through the process, they start to realise actually I have actually got more of an influence on my child because of my domestic abuse behaviour. We recognise that, as I mentioned earlier, that men do tend to be resistant in engaging in the programme. Or engaging in any work, initially looking at their own behaviours. There has been a lot of research done on, as I mentioned earlier, about when do men do resisting using child protection services and addressing their behaviour. And what we found is, a part of the evaluation, as Michael said earlier, as practitioners we were asked for feedback, direct feedback about what it was, how we engaged with those fathers that actually helped in the process of change. And these are some of the tips that we came up with. It is about having a positive and non-judgmental attitude. A lot of men feel that they have never had an opportunity to talk about their experiences. A lot of the time they feel that they are seen as monsters or as evil. A lot of the men themselves do feel, have a level of insight or awareness that they do feel guilt for their behaviours. And what they were finding was that when they're dealing with a lot of professionals, that was being compared, that they were actually being felt shameful. So they then resist, became hostile, disengaged from services. Again, thankfully that's changed in a lot of professionals that I see, that these are men who do want to change, who do have a lot of insight, that they do see the impact of their abusive behaviours. So we do have to have a positive view and a non-judgmental attitude. These are men who have been influenced by their experiences and who, I suppose, in a sense, when we look at the change cycle, when they actually start under the programme, they are at that stage where they recognise that there's something that needs to change, and that's a starting point for us. There's a lot of men who will be referred to the service and who don't actually get past the referral or the assessment stage because they're not at that stage, they're still in denial. For those men who are at the ambivalent stage of the change process, that will be our start. But at the start, to recognise there's something not right here, and we need help for that and changing. Empathise but don't collude. Again, it's about recognising these are men who have been influenced, who have had childhood experiences, who've lived life and have had life experiences. They may have had health issues, maybe addiction issues. They may have themselves been experienced domestic abuse with their own childhood. That all would have influenced how they see them as a father, that's how they see or view what a healthy relationship is. They may view what they're being controlled in as help as normal because that's what they were used to as children. So when we have to recognise that they're humans with a life experience, we also can't include, or we also have to hold them to account. We tend to focus on the child's needs. Again, it's about the motivating factor, isn't it? Fathers who do have genuine care for their children and want the best for them, they want the child to grow up healthy and strong and well. And we maintain that focus. It's not about blaming them, it's not about saying that they're not responsible or giving them a justification for their behaviour. This is your child, you have genuine concerns and love for your child, but you also want them to grow up and have their strong. This is how your behaviour is impacting on that, and how you change will benefit them. And that's one of the reasons for identifying the positive reasons for changing, but maintaining the focus on the child. Mentioned earlier about recognising whether he is ready to change, bring us back to the change in the process, and some of the men aren't ready to change. So with men, another bit that we may be at loss at that ambivalent stage, then we can work about this. And as practitioners, it is about just reflecting on our own knowledge and practice in terms of, especially now in terms of social media, we often see less in terms of looking at abusive behaviours. We see less physical abuse within relationships, and that is a lot more to do with coercion and control and use of social media around that. So it's about us being aware of those changes in society as well. The evaluation, just a wee bit about, because the current ads programme was delivered across 5 sites in the UK, across England, Wales and Northern Ireland. Belfast, Service Centre, and also Friday, because we were involved in the preventative service. Between October 2012, I think it was 2014, 2010 and 2014, those 4 years, there was services run to those five sites. There was 350 participants took part and completed the programme. 350 participants took part. 54% of those completed the programme and completed the evaluations. There's three points of data collection. The first point was whenever the men first started the group on the first session. They were given questionnaires in relation to their understanding in terms of self-esteem. There's also questionnaires in relation to poverty control and also parental stress as well. Those same questionnaires were then completed at T2, which was at the completion of the programme, and then was a six-month follow-up, and then whenever those same data was collected. They also had the mothers and children partners and ex-partners were also asked to take part as well, and also the children were given the opportunity to engage and give them feedback. There is smaller numbers for the partners and smaller numbers for the children, principally because of the needs of the children. A lot of the men over the five sites, range was about between 1966, but the vast majority of those were born in Orion and younger Orion, so they were young fathers with young families. So the data that they did for the children unfortunately was a lot was smaller. So I'm happy with some of that feedback. So the evaluation was completed, data was collected up until 2014. NSPCC published the research on the outcomes of evaluation in March last year, and that's available from the website. The main findings was that the service does contribute to reducing risks to children. The children's circumstances changed in terms of a lot of the children may have been on child protection plan part of the child protection register. Due to the completion of the programme and what was being observed by social services, being observed by the interaction of the fathers with the children, being observed between the interaction between the mothers and the partner, was that those risks were reduced to an extent where they were no longer with the threshold for doing a child protection register. For others, it was a case of social workers being involved at all, social work involvement was reduced them, I think was taken away. We also found that the children themselves were having more positive contact with the father. Again, some of the contact would have been supervised or unsupervised, might have been in the contact centre, but that contact then changed to be very unsupervised and very in the community. And it was more positive, and that was feedback from the children was saying that they found the dance would be more, it was more fun, less moody. The children wouldn't actually be as scared or as worried going to have contact. They weren't being asked questions, you know, how's your, what's your mom doing? And then they were feeling torn between what they're saying, anything about their dad. What they were fighting was that the dads doing contact was more positive, it was about them. By just playing with the children, not worrying about what mom was doing. So just had that time with the dads. And contact did increase. Contact maybe just weekly for 3 hours, and that increased probably two or three times each week. And for some, it actually did to launch first contact. There was also evidence of the positive improvements in the father's behaviour. So again, the children talked about seeing the father more often because he had changed. He was more pleasant, he was more focused on them. The children felt that they were being valued, that they were being prioritised. They felt more confident and more comfortable in life being with their father. Fathers found that being a parent was less stressful, because they felt that they were able to interact more positively with the children. We were finding that they would take more effort in terms of what children to contact, what to, in terms of checking out the child, what was doing more child centre, what would the child like to do with the contact, as opposed to the dad just meeting his parents had the need to have contact with his child. What started to happen was a shift towards the father just being more focused on meeting the needs of the child, as opposed to being I suppose meeting the need within themselves to have contact. And that improvement was sustained, and it contributed to the increased feelings of safety and well-being within the families. Because again, the mothers felt that whenever they had contact with whenever the children were returning for contact, for example, that the child was more happy, the child was, felt, she was actually feeling that she didn't feel any more stress because the child was more relaxed, wasn't coming home tearful, didn't feel like they were being encouraged to ask a lot of questions. So for the fact that the children were enjoying the contact and enjoying the time with the father, then that impacted them also and influenced on the mother. There was fewer reported incidents of domestic abuse after completion of the programme. I suppose a lot of these key factors that we need to bear in mind is that it is across the five sites within the UK, which would have different aspects in terms of contact and different judicial systems as well, different thresholds in terms of child protection. So for example, within the Belfast Service Standard, what we found was that there was actually no reported incidents of domestic abuse by the father should complete the program, at least by a 6 month period, a 6 month follow up. And I'm saying that because we don't actually know that the evaluation will refer more to what all the sites found. Partners describe fathers as more cooperative and recognising the impact of the domestic abuse on children, both in terms of the children themselves but also their ability to do their parents as well. But it is recognised that not all fathers change sufficiently despite completing the programme. There is recognition that for some of the fathers there was issues brought up throughout the programme that they hadn't, issues that they hadn't addressed, that was then impacting on their ability to be a father. But what we found was that we really made the signpost then to alternative or more appropriate services as well. One of the big things about the programme is that it's multidisciplinary in nature, and it does take involvement in all services, both in terms of social services. We work a lot within referrers the principal referrers will be social services, and we work in partnership with social services in terms of giving feedback throughout the process of the programme. Because that feedback is it's a form of assessment as well, because obviously when we are liaising and working with social services and giving feedback in terms of any changes that we are seeing within the group, that information obviously is going into that decision making process in terms of contact, in terms of whether the child continues to meet the threshold for being able to register. So it is about working with social services, child protection agencies, and also the criminal justice system, and we're going to have to work in a collaborative way. Just some feedback from the next partner involved in the service. Just said that she felt more reassured about her former partner. It's the first time that she had seen an improvement in him, and that he was really proud to listen. The child was interviewed, it's a long quote, but possibly the child was saying that it would have more of a laugh, it felt easier and freer to joke and look around. But he just treated the child differently, and I think that's a recognition of the father being letting and having more of an awareness of the child's needs, who this child was. Just that the child was felt more happy because the dad was less moody. a caring dad himself said that it has strengthened his relationship with the child and believes that his mother is a better person in all aspects of his life. It's interesting that in terms of being taught that the model for children was what I was talking about at the start, around the first three sessions, about fathers becoming more aware of how their own experiences influence their views and attitudes on the role of a father, the role of the mother, and relationships. It's very positive then that when a father can see being a role model, how important that is. Because then what we often found in the assessment sessions when we're looking at geographic things was the intergenerational aspect of domestic abuse. One of the programming that fathers realise the impact of domestic abuse on their children, those children will have a more positive impact, more positive understanding of their role as a male, as a father, or a partner, and take that further onto their own relationships. So it has, it's very positive in terms of those generational aspects as well. Going forward, imagine NSPCC have completed the evaluations and completed the report. The service itself has the model that NSPCC works on is to provide the service, evaluate it, and then promote it for other agencies or other organisations to take on board and to provide. So China and our NSPCC staff will be providing the service in that from this summer onwards. But obviously we know that the service is still required, that there's still a lot more domestic abuse in China, they're still continuing to be impacted and exposed to domestic abuse. So what we are in a position to do, regional services are in a position to offer, you know, consultation advice in terms of sharing that knowledge for other organisations or agencies who want to take that on board. This BAFAS itself is in current negotiations with regional health and social care trusts about providing, continuing to provide the service from BAFAS. And also, there's coming up in February, towards the end of February in Leeds, there's ongoing training. So if anybody is interested in coming to the facility, then there is training being provided by Ben, Karina and Tim. The thing is though that there's a cost provided and whereas Belfast Service Centre doesn't, we don't, it can be done, we can do that scale up, we can do that knowledge transfer at no cost. We really have to go to these and we have a sense of clarity on what a person would have ever done with the joint contact sense that we pass this to the other one. So I probably, in my head, was supposed to last 10 minutes, but probably in actuality, it probably lasted a lot more than that. I don't know if there's any questions.
My name on this, so I'll introduce myself. My name's Fiona Campbell and I'm one of the social work practitioners based here in Belfast. I'm going to talk about the Family Smiles programme. The acronym SMILES, you can see underneath there, is based on simplifying mental illness plus life enhancement skills. So what I'm going to do is just give you a brief overview of the programme and then have a look at some of the key findings of what's actually an interim evaluation report. The final evaluation is due to be published in March. So this programme is an NSPCC adaptation of the Family Smiles programme that was really, created by Erica Pittman, and it originally involved group work with young people who were classed as young carers. The NSPCC programme decided that they felt maybe a whole family approach would be appropriate. So they basically introduced this programme which aimed to improve the children's self-esteem, resilience and life skills, but also to help the parent or carer develop the understanding of the impact of their mental illness on the child and improve protective parenting. So a point of referral, then there's an initial assessment which takes place with both, if the parent's well enough, and involves the young person in the family as well. Generally it's about 4 sessions, and that's about assessing, is the parent well enough to participate? Is the programme right for the child and or the parent or carer? Following, if the assessment indicates that it's appropriate to proceed, then there's a group work programme for the young people, which is 8 weekly sessions during which the young people get involved in creative activities, discussions, and age-appropriate education around mental illness and life skills, what to do in an emergency. And alongside the programme then, up to 6 individual sessions are offered to junior parents to help them understand the impact of their illness, and also to support the children through that group process. Then at the conclusion of the programme, there's one further session with the aim of pulling together a plan which, should the parent or carer experience a deterioration in their mental health, that there's a plan in place that family members and the children are familiar with. It's really important that the child's wishes and views are taken into consideration in this plan, because sometimes when parents may be admitted to hospital in an unplanned manner, circumstances take over, and then it's maybe 2 or 3 days later, what's happened to the dog, or who's looking after the family pets? So really the child's contribution to that is key. That's just some research statistics around mental health. 175 serious case reviews find that 53% of cases featured parental mental health problems. 144,000 babies in the UK live with an adult with a common mental disorder. At least 10% of women experience anxiety or depression in the perinatal period. And although most parents with a mental health problem do not abuse their children, parental mental health problems are a common feature in child protection investigations. So the rest of this presentation is based, as I said, on the interim evaluation. The service itself was delivered across 9 sites, 9 NSPCC sites in the UK, including Belfast. The evaluation saw evidence around key outcomes around increasing self-esteem among children and young people, reducing emotional behavioural difficulties, and enhancing the protective parenting behaviours. I have a copy here today, or if you're interested, you can access the interim evaluation report via the NSPCC website. There were a variety of measures used, both pre-assessment, pre-programme intervention at and conclusion of the programme, and then a 6-month follow-up. The evaluations were completed by both the young people themselves, the parent or carer, and also involved professional feedback and practitioner feedback from those that were actually delivering the service. The interim evaluation indicated that the well-being of children improved by the end of the programme. It showed the value of a short intervention which enabled family members to gain positive insights into themselves and their interactions with others. It indicated improved communication within the family around the mental illness and highlighted the value of the whole family approach. It suggests the programme does bridge a gap between adult mental health and children's services. And it drew attention to the value of the service for all families where parental mental health problems are parental mental health problems regardless of any prior childhood protection or welfare concerns. Suggestions for improvement in that evaluation was that the content of the group could be, group programme could be expanded to include issues relating to domestic abuse. The location of the group and access to transport was a key factor in maintaining the continuity, particularly the young people's attendance. Scheduling with the sessions to ensure they didn't clash with other services, which is very difficult when you're trying to manage a group of maybe up to 8 young people coming from different areas. Parents felt a more positive image of NSPCC would help them feel more comfortable about attending. Very often that's one of the first blocks that we have to overcome with NSPCC, as seen as the cruelty people. And they suggest that an improvement would be provision of a longer term or drop-in support at conclusion of the programme. So next steps, the interim findings have been assessed by a systemic review which has resulted in the NSPCC partnering with the University of Manchester and the Health Trust to deliver an amended programme called Young Smiles. And the final evaluation report is due to be published in March, and again that can be accessed by NSPCC website. Locally here we have, in Belfast, we've ceased to deliver the service, but we're currently seeking opportunities for knowledge exchange with agencies and organisations that may wish to deliver the programme themselves. And as part of that, NSPCC will facilitate 2 days training and support the agency with delivery of one of the groups. Just prior to Christmas, 10 external practitioners were trained in the programme, and they anticipate to deliver the programme within their own service and in referral criteria. If anybody would like any further information, Lisa Webb, the team manager that has responsibility for Family Smiles, can be contacted at Belfast Service Centre. Any further information you can get from the NSPCC website. Thank you.
Short presentation, so there's a lot of information there. I'm going to try to keep this one fairly contained. I'm Desi O'Hagan and I manage the Turn the Page service in Craigavon Centre. And we deliver a service to the Southern Trust and Western Trust. And just for your information, there are two other services within Northern Ireland that provide harmful sexual behaviour assessment and treatment services. And both are within the Trust. One is making changes in the Northern Board. I think it's making changes. In the Northern Board, and in the South East in Belfast, it's Aim to Change Now, which used to be provided by Barnardo's.
You have the older programme as well, in innovation. You work with adults?
Yeah.
Or you only work with adolescents?
Under the Turn the Page, it's an umbrella term for a number of services which assess and provide treatment to children and young people where there's identified harmful sexual behaviour. So, you know, we work with under 12s, which is a different approach to over 12s.
Okay.
We work with young people with learning difficulties and some with mild learning disabilities. We work with young people on the autistic spectrum range, and we work with young girls over 12 and under 12. Just in terms of the what I wanted to talk to you about today is our evaluation of a manualised approach, and the manual is actually was written by Eamon McCrory, and it is Change for Good. So if you think back to what it's saying about turning the page, it's an umbrella term for a number of services. This is one of the services. And Change for Good is a manualised approach to treating young people who have displayed harmful sexual behaviour. And just a wee bit of background as to why we would want to do this. NSPCC have had a long history of working with young people with harmful sexual behaviour. I think whenever I started working as a trust social worker along with NSPCC would have been in about 1993-94 when the service was just being set up. So that's how far it goes back. I think at that stage there was a lot of services developing in relation to harmful sexual behaviour because it was being recognised as a significant issue which needed to be addressed. In terms of the context, two-thirds of contact sexual abuse experienced by children and young people is perpetrated by peers. That comes from the NSPCC prevalence study. So that doesn't necessarily mean that those cases are known to social services or to juvenile justice. Those are young people who were asked questions in confidence and were able to say that they did experience sexual assaults and that they were by peers. Other research found that 30 to 50% of all sexual abuse was perpetrated by adolescents, mostly boys. And there has been little research on what treatment approaches are effective for HSB. So as you can see, it is the tip of the iceberg. So as we said earlier on there, turn the page is a manualised approach to addressing this issue. It's focused, it's targeted at young people 12 to 18. Young people who don't have a learning disability or learning difficulty and who have a level of reading and writing which will allow them to work through the manual. So you can see from what I was saying earlier there in terms of the turn the page services, this is a very narrow spectrum of those group of young people. So it consists of the manual really is about it gives you the directions as to how to use the sessions, and the sessions are about 26 in total, but there's allowance for adding 3 or 4 or maybe more if a young person needs some work on a particular area. So that means that the young person, all young people referred to NSPCC for harmful sexual behaviour will have aim assessment undertaken with them, and the aim assessment generally takes about 6 to 12 weeks and involves a number of interviews with the young person as well as a review of files. So you can see how the young person can be involved with us for a number of weeks or months before we actually move to treatment. We need an assessment to understand what the treatment needs are. So all the young people referred to us will have some sort of an aim assessment. The aim provide an under 12 assessment and an over 12 assessment, that's 12 to 18, and they can be used with young people with learning difficulty or mild disability. The Change for Good approach is based, is sense-based. I think, you know, a lot of the speakers before us were talking about, you know, looking at the positives in the first instance when working with people rather than all the negatives. And it is sense-based, it's largely cognitive behavioural, and it draws on an understanding of attachment. It also uses mentalisation. If any has worked with adolescents, you will understand that empathy doesn't come easily to young adolescents, so we will use an aspect of empathy which is understanding it from another person's perspective. It's very concrete for young people, and they get that. And of course, a psychodynamic approach. You can't work with the young people and build up a relationship with them and not understand or pick up on unspoken or metaphorical issues which they're bringing to the work and the sessions. And of course, systems theory. The manual is made up of four modules, and the first module is the engagement model, or sorry, the engagement module, relationships, self-regulation, and then roadmap to the future. It's pretty structured, and it involves giving the young people homeworks for it to take home and to complete on their own and to bring back to the next session. As you can imagine, you know, young people who are referred to this, many young people who perpetrate harmful sexual behaviour will have some, not necessarily sexual, but some element of victimisation in their past. You know, should that be exposure to domestic violence, the toxic trio, mental health within the family, and substance abuse or alcohol. So they will have, and many of the kids will see that as normal for their family, but we know from research that causes a level of trauma for the young people. So they will have had some level of chaos within their lives. So we bring a very structured approach to this, and that can be quite difficult for young people, and that's why we need that engagement module. And the whole thing, as you probably all know, in terms of any therapeutic intervention with young people, needs to be based on that relationship. They reckon by 70-90% of positive engagement is about relationship rather than the actual model that you bring to it. But we still need to know what works whenever we're using models and approaches with young people. So the evaluation of this approach, the Change for Good manual, was about how effective is the manual in reducing the risk and bringing about change. What we have achieved now is the first part of that evaluation. We need to understand in the long term whether or not young people reoffend again. So there is going to be a longitudinal follow-up, which young people have already given permission for the evaluators to access criminal justice records in the future. So how effective is the manual in reducing risk and bringing about change? With whom and in what circumstances, given what we've talked about, the narrow range of young people that we're working with whom and in what circumstances the manual is most effective? How can the delivery of the manual be improved? It's qualitative and it's quantitative. Standardised measures were used by the practitioner working with the young people at the beginning, T1, T2, T3. And it's also a case study approach with in-depth interviews by the evaluators. So what were the findings? The findings were that we developed, I suppose, you know, from my perspective as somebody who's been working in this field for such a long time, and for the practitioners who were involved, you know, they could have come up with some of the headlines of what they would like to define using a strict manual approach themselves, but of course we need the science, we need the data for to be able to be 100% sure of those outcomes. There was more understanding by the young people of what is unacceptable sexual behaviour, the triggers for PTSD, and having strategies to manage these. As I'm saying earlier, a lot of the young people who are referred to us come from that background where they've had some level of traumatisation or victimisation. Maybe a chaotic background, attachment issues. So many of them will come to us with thinking errors, because when you think about them, you know, 12 to 16, 18, you know, is a very short space of time for young people, and it's within that period of time, within that formal operational development phase, that they are able to develop that more complex level of thinking than the younger children. Lunchtime. So a lot of the ideas that we're bringing to them, given that some of them have been traumatised and fixated and have internalised the things that they've seen in their childhood, a lot of that is like a window of perception for them, being able to open that for them. And we will only be able to do that with a strong relationship with them. So the young people began to think things through before acting, to become more aware of other people's perspectives. And if you think about creating that space, that dialogue with the young people, because a lot of it's about that relationship, about opening up discussions, about reviewing past, about them being able to create that space within their own heads, but to understand what triggers their process and why they do and say and think particular things. Young people also became more confident and less withdrawn. And like all the other services, we take a very unjudgmental approach to the work with the young people. Yes, they are accountable enough when we're working with the Youth Justice Agency. You know, there is a strong accountability aspect, but we don't judge them on what they've done. They know that they have done wrong, but we don't try to create that punitive atmosphere. So we find that adds to their resilience and builds their resilience, and the young people become much more confident through that relationship. The young people will help to make sense of their lives and feel better about themselves. And again, that's to do about with the young people being able to see their lives in a longitudinal context. And I'm thinking back to some of Cleve's stuff around fathers being able to look back at how they were parented and how they go on to parent their children. Some of this also happens with these young people. It becomes reflective for them, and that's positive. As I've emphasised, there is that strong therapeutic relationship between the young person and the practitioner was important. As conversations became more easy, issues and emotions previously unaddressed could be uncovered and clarified. Again, we're back to the psychodynamic approach. And the psychodynamic aspect, I suppose, we find doesn't really begin to become apparent until we're well into the sessions and the young person's trust has developed. What we did become very mindful of, which would have been the case in other approaches that we have taken, is that these young people, many of these young people, have suffered some level of trauma. Should that be slow trauma from exposure to neglect or domestic violence or poor parenting, attachment, mental health. And sometimes what we had to do was to press the hold button and either refer the young person for specialised trauma treatment or for us to use our own trauma approach. And for that we would have used some of you may be familiar with it, the trauma symptoms checklist, which really could identify some of those symptoms of the trauma that they had experienced. So that gave us some measurement for us to work with that trauma. The practitioners, while following the manual closely, often had to be creative to meet objectives if the prescribed approach was not suitable for the young people. And I suppose that is similar to how we would have worked before we were using the manualised approach. Very much moving off the view that any treatment needed to be based on what the young people's assessed needs were. So this was in the first stages a bit uncomfortable for us because everybody was getting 26 plus 4 or whatever sessions, and in not all cases do we feel that that's what they actually needed. Some young people found it difficult to implement the strategies learned in the programme when the input from practitioners finished. That's understandable. External support had sometimes been built in through the use of mentors to follow up appointments to provide continued support. Our approach was always and will always be multidisciplinary, so whenever we have engaged with the young person, we try to engage
everybody within their environment, from the professionals to the family to the carers to the residential unit. So what we try to do is to generalise anything that the young person has learned within the work with us into other contexts. So our process is about enabling all the other carers with the young person to understand the approach that we have taken and to implement that through their environment. I'm seeing Yvonne there at the back, that Yvonne will know from the Youth Justice Agency that that would have been an approach that we would have used a lot in the past. Again, like the other research, if you go on to the NSPCC website, you'll be able to see this first part of the evaluation and information in regards how this will be followed up in the future. Any questions?
I'm Health Service Centre, and I'm going to talk to you today about our LTFI programme, Let Me Give Children. And as you can see, it's a therapeutic recovery programme for children and young people who have experienced sexual abuse. And really, the therapeutic recovery service for children and young people who have experienced sexual abuse really came into being in the mid-90s, certainly for Foyle. I'm not sure what Craig Gavin's story is, but that's the other service centre here that runs LTFI. But really, our programme in Foyle was in response to two large-scale investigations into organised child sexual abuse within the city. And it was recognised that there wasn't therapeutic support for young people who had experienced abuse. From that, over the last few years, the NSPCC have decided that we really need to be focusing on evidence-based practice. And as a result, all of our programmes have been or are in the process of being evaluated. So LTFI, we looked at the research around, the programme is really informed by a programme of research, survivor feedback, children and young people's views and practitioner wisdom, and that has all led to the development of the Let Me Give Children programme. It draws on developments over the last 3 decades in understanding what works in the assessment and therapeutic intervention of children and young people who have been sexually abused. And it aims to ameliorate the corrosive impact on children and young people. So who's it for? This is for children aged 4 to 17 who have disclosed sexual abuse. And the age range that we take complies with the therapeutic assessment tools that we produce, and I'll discuss that in more detail later. We're very clear that the service has to be based on choice. It's not the choice of the parent, it's not the choice of the carer or the social worker. The choice is very much that of the child. And the thinking behind that is that when a child or young person is sexually abused, they had absolutely no choice. And we start that process of giving choice back to them. Originally, our only referral pathway was from social services. We now take referrals from CAMS. We take referrals from other services within the organisation, such as face-to-face and in the domestic abuse teams. We take referrals from GPs, and we also take from schools and some young people self-refer. The main criteria is that these children and young people are safe from any further abuse, and where possible, that the information in relation to the alleged perpetrator has been passed on to the authorities and investigations can take place. So the process is that we undertake a therapeutic assessment. We have a safe care assessment, then we move to the intervention phase, and we have reviews and joint work. In the assessment phase, we use 4 sessions to rapport build and start developing a therapeutic relationship with the service users. We undertake home visits, and that will help us get an idea of what the situation is for the family and the relationship between the parent or the carer and the child. We would have discussions, usually our older, the teenagers, the adolescents, they would engage in discussion more rather than the more creative work. We would do life journeys, genograms, all that kind of work. And you can see there, as Desi referred to earlier on, the trauma symptom checklist for children, and we also have the trauma symptom checklist for young children. That the trauma symptom checklist for children is a document. It has 54 questions approximately, and it was devised by John Briere. And within that, we would have a number of areas, including post-traumatic stress disorder, sexual distress, dissociation. There are a number of critical questions, and depending on the child or young person's score on that, we would explore that in more depth to identify any immediate risks to that child or young person and whether they actually feel safe in their current environment. It underlines the other assessment tools that we use, such as the checklist, the measuring scale, and the paper dolls. And it identifies impact issues that are at a concerning or a clinical range. The questions around sexual issues, they identify issues with relationships and intimacy, and also whether the child or young person is placing themselves at risk or they become promiscuous when they're taking risks in their own lives. The paper dolls is a really interesting exercise, and we use it with all of our young people and our children, and it has basically a string of paper dolls, and that includes the child, their family, those closest to them, and the alleged perpetrator. And what it looks to identify is where the child places blame, who the child feels was hurt by the abuse, who the child feels was brave, and things like that. So that can show any distorted thinking and any kind of concerns for their alleged perpetrator. Where a child is under 8, the parents or the carers complete the trauma symptom checklist for young children. And that considers responses in the context of the child and whether those responses match the child's presentation with the practitioner. So the practitioner and I sit down, we'll look at the scores, and we'll discuss what the practitioner has seen in their sessions with the child. Where you have a tendency to overscore on the trauma symptom check or the TSCYC, it can identify the parents' anxieties more so than the child's, and where they're preoccupied with their child's abuse and the impact on their child. And quite often, parents see their abused child rather than seeing their child who was abused, and that's a really big issue for them. And it can identify the impact on the parents as opposed to the child, but it gives us an understanding of where the work should go with the parents. Both of these scores can be invalid as well, due to hyper or underscoring, but we would still continue working with the children. We would disregard that, but we would be aware of some of the issues identified within it. We would also, part of our skills and knowledge basis around child development, attachment, all that, but we're also tuned in to the impact of abuse, the impact on the child's psychological, social and behavioural development. Emotional abuse is implicitly present within all sexual abuse, and that is mediated by the relationship between the abuser and the child. When a child is the subject of sexual abuse, their body is used by others to meet another person's need. The abuse means they're not touched or treated in a way that is consistent with their development or their own needs. Their world becomes unsafe, their reactions distorted, and their relationships with adults and others around them become skewed. The child's internal working models, unlike adults, are still being formed, their brain's still developing, and these become permeated with abuse-related information about their self, the abuser, and the world. And that's really what the TSCC would pick up on. The physical impact of child sexual abuse, as I'm sure you're aware, is the risk of STIs, pregnancy, or infection, and also possibly sterility later life. Part of the research done in developing the LTFI was the work of van der Kolk, which was in relation to neuroscience. And that recent developments in neuroscience has revealed the extent to which children's brains' development and brain activity are affected by the associated trauma. And as a result, their more general development is impacted upon, and that affects their capacity for learning and focusing attention. They may then come to live in a state of preparedness for negative emotions, and that affects their general information processing, and that's a state of hyper or hypoarousal. So the literature identifies 5 broad areas affected by sexual abuse, and some of them I've mentioned already, the impact on the brain and brain development, the threats to the physical health, the impact on psychological function and mental health, including increased levels of depression, suicidal ideation, self-blame, self-harm, anxiety, dissociation, post-traumatic stress disorder, and emotional consequences such as anger, fear, guilt, and shame. And we would see that quite significantly and the service users that come to us, and we don't really need the TSCC to identify that, it's there and it's evident. There's also an impact on child and adult behaviour and the relationships, and they have a difficulty forming trust in relationships relating to peers, and on occasion we would have inappropriate sexual behaviour. What we noticed as well, and what's evident in the work that we've done, is the importance of a carer who believes the child and who is supportive of the child. And as you can see there, the Department of Health supports that. So we recognise the important role that parents or carers have in their child's recovery. And we've always said to parents or carers that's the biggest factor in a child's recovery, is having a supportive parent. The term used in the LTFI is safe care, and that doesn't mean just keeping the child physically safe. That is about providing the emotional support and the ability to provide the emotional support to the child in their recovery. They need to be emotionally available to the child, and in our safe care assessment we look at the parent's own background, their own history, experiences of abuse, domestic abuse, neglect, child sexual abuse, etc. So this identifies vulnerabilities within the parent that might impact on their ability to support their child in the recovery. And so we would offer them a series of sessions to our parents to help them support their child. I've been in this work for 12 years, and quite often what we find is that parents have their own experiences of child sexual abuse. We will work on that. Our services there purposely focus on the child and support the parent and supporting the child, but we would signpost them to organisations such as Nexus. We have had occasions where parents have discussed their own abuse with their children. This isn't appropriate. Everybody's experience is different, and it's important that the parent gets the support that they need. Once the assessment is completed, we would share it with the child or young person and the parent. Within that, not all the information shared by parents will be contained in the assessment that's on the child's file, particularly where the parent themselves has shared their own abuse. It's not appropriate. And depending on the age of the child as well, they don't always want the parent to hear all the information that's on there, and their assessment and the information that they've shared. So we negotiate with that with the child. We then offer a maximum of 30 sessions to the child or the young person to work through the different areas of trauma. Sometimes it takes more, quite often it doesn't take as many. And again, the element of choice is there for the child. They prioritise the impact issues that they want to work upon. Quite often you'll see a child who's identified with maybe 10 impact issues. Once you start working through them, you realise that having dealt with nightmares or anger, you see an improvement in some of the other symptoms, so that they don't work through all the impact issues. We use a variety of media to support the child, and it's tailored to their individual needs. Young children often they're not able to describe their feelings, they're not able to to understand their feelings and why they're feeling as they are. So we work on emotional literacy. We would do life maps and genograms. We would use a lot of the books by Margot Sutherland, which are really, really good with young children. We work on dissociation based on the work of René Marx. Beverly James, working with traumatised children, so that's absolutely a Bible to us. But there's a variety of media that we use, CBT, play therapy. We also undertake some socio-educative work with both parents and service users in terms of how perpetrators operate and helping them to understand the grooming process and how they were targeted. Our work is reviewed every 90 days, and we look then at what work is outstanding at that stage. And towards the end of the work, we would have joint sessions with the child and their safe carer, and that would help them communicate about the abuse and develop their relationship. So that's me. There's gone back up that. Our evaluation was published last year, and it was undertaken by the universities of Bristol and Durham. 242 children aged 6 to 16 years took part, and a number of them were from Northern Ireland. Three quarters were girls and 1 in 6 was disabled. Most had experienced contact, sexual abuse, inappropriate touching and penetration. They're almost twice as likely to have been abused by someone in their family as by someone outside it. And 4 in 10 known perpetrators were under the age of 18 and almost all were male. And that ties in with Desi's statistics here. So, when a child was referred to us during the assessment phase, they immediately did the TSCC, and then they were put into a randomised, was randomly put into the computer, and they were assigned to either the control group, which meant that they didn't get the service for 6 months, or they were moved to intervention straight away. Where there were concerns about a child's safety or child protection issues, they were automatically offered a service. At 6 months, they were then offered a service, and the TSCC was undertaken at that stage. And for those in intervention, the TSCC was also undertaken at 6 months, and that gave us the results that we can see here. So the proportion of older children and young people in the intervention group with clinical plus significant difficulty had reduced from 73% to 46%, which was quite a significant improvement. So the younger children, there was no change in either the intervention or control group over the 6 months, but there was some evidence of a reduction in the intervention group at the 12-month follow-up. This suggests that improvements may take longer to achieve or to be recognised by the carers who completed the measures, and also in terms of the children, a young child's understanding of what sexual abuse is and what exactly has happened to them. So that's me. Is there any questions?